I built myself a NAS that covers a lot of functionality. It's a storage for footage, and now I can edit 4K videos directly from it. It's a collection of movies that are now available on any device. It's my photo gallery. And finally, all my photos are collected in one place. It's not just a 24 TB of cloud storage. It has way more features. And most importantly, I had to pay for it just once. Just a year ago, I had no idea that NAS existed. And if you don't know either, roughly speaking, it's an external storage device that can be accessed over your local network and, if necessary, over the internet. But under the hood, it's just a simple PC with a special operating system. In other words, it's your home server. Seeing the struggles of other YouTubers who collect piles of hard drives and external SSDs for work, and seeing that I was running out of disk space, I had a choice. Either fall into the same trap, or stay one step ahead. Besides, storing data on an SSD is just not safe. Just like with PC, building your own NAS is much cheaper than ready-made solutions from large companies. But to be honest, the topic is not that simple. The main task is to plan carefully based on the intended use and budget, so that it stands out the test of time. The main difficulty for me was gathering information, because no matter how many videos I watched, they either explained the most basic things or used very technical language, as if I were building a NAS every day. And some videos were frankly outdated. After each video, I still had questions. So I decided to make a video in which I share my results and also summarize my knowledge in simple and understandable language using my NAS as an example. This may be useful for building any NAS. But let me say right away that this will not be a step-by-step guide. There are experts in this field, and I will refer to them myself. Here I'm just sharing experience of building one, and I'm doing so in simple words, but with a Slavic accent. I initially looked at the pre-built solutions from Synology and others, but the more I looked into it, the more I realized that they were too expensive for my needs. And sometimes even imposed restrictions on purchase of hard drives from certain brands, as it was the case with Synology. But no one knows what stupid decision they'll come up with tomorrow, so I'd better build my own. Based on my experience, I can break down building a NAS into these main steps. Some of them are optional, focused on improving and optimizing the NAS. My tasks included editing 4K videos, with everything else being secondary. For these, I needed a large amount of storage and data integrity. By that, I mean a RAID array. There are different types of RAIDs, but roughly speaking, their purpose is to duplicate data so that if something happens to one of the drives, the data is preserved on another drive. Before I came up with this idea of building a NAS, I installed two 12 TB drives in my PC in a mirrored RAID. Those 12 TB would have lasted another 4 years. But after that, it will be difficult to increase the capacity. Maximum read speed was 250 megabytes a second, which seemed to be enough, but sometimes there was a delay during video playback. But mirrored RAID is the most expensive type of RAID, because if I add another 12 TB drive and change it to RAID 5, I will have twice as much storage available. And from data integrity standpoint, if one hard drive falls...
When one falls, not if, when.
All the data will still be intact. In addition, in such a RAID, the read speed would double, but the write speed would remain the same. By the same logic, if I bought 6x6 TB drives instead of 3x12 TB, the read speed would have been even higher. But fewer drives mean less noise. And it will be easier to add more drives if necessary in the future. If I had enough space for a third drive in the case, maybe I wouldn't have built a NAS. Since the hard drives will be running 24/7, it is worth choosing models designed for such a load. I chose Western Digital Red Plus 12 TB, which has the best performance characteristics, but it turned out to be quite noisy. Knowing what I know today, I would just choose others. And the fact that the read-write speed is lower is not a problem, as it can be solved in other ways. In total, they cost me €850, but they should last for many years. Remember I said that the more hard drives you have, the higher the read speed in RAID? There is a caveat, as the NAS will be connected via an Ethernet cable, and this can become a bottleneck. When choosing a motherboard for a NAS, it is always worth looking at the network port. It can be 1 gigabit, 2.5, 5, and 10 gigabits. My PC's motherboard has a 10 gigabit port, and of course I wanted to use its full potential. I started looking at prices and was shocked. There is an option to find a simpler motherboard and buy a network card, but it cost about 100 euro on its own. But after looking through thousands of options, I came across this motherboard on AliExpress. It includes a CPU with a fan, a 10 gigabit port, 2x 2.5 gigabit ports, 6 SATA ports, and 2 slots for M.2 SSDs, for less than 200 euros. It has an energy-efficient mobile CPU from Intel N series, available in 4 and 8 cores version, but will they be able to handle my tasks? I thought about it for a long time, and even found an option with Ryzen 8845HX, which would be significantly more performant, but more than twice as expensive. In the end, it just needs to work with files, so I choose 4-core option and have no regrets. And the built-in graphics handle video decoding perfectly, if you use it for streaming movies like I do. How much RAM should you get? I got 16 gigs, but later regretted not buying 32 gigs right away. More on that later. At this point, I have a mini ITX motherboard and 3 hard drives, so now I can choose a case. I found some budget options that could accommodate all of this, but I really liked this case. In addition, it has 6 slots for hard drives, which means it will be possible to scale up in the future, plus 2 slots for SATA SSDs, which will also be needed. And again, I got it from AliExpress. It arrived quickly and was fairly easy to assemble. I watched a bunch of comparison videos, and it turned out to be that all this information was outdated, and both versions has already been merged into one. And this greatly simplifies the task. The installation was easy, just use this app right away to create a bootable flash drive. Don't waste your time on other apps as I did. For TrueNAS OS, it is recommended to have a separate SSD, and I initially installed OS on an M.2 SSD. But later, I regretted taking up one of the M.2 slots for that. And again, more on that later. My guide for installation and configuration was this guy from the Hardware Haven channel. He explains everything perfectly, and I will leave a link to his video if you need it. At this stage, I already had a fully functional NAS. It must be connected to both your PC and your router at the same time. If your PC has only one Ethernet port, you will either have to use Wi-Fi or buy and configure a switch. One of those. It's easier for me in this regard, as I have 2 ports on the motherboard. One for the internet and other, which is 10 gigabit, for the NAS. The Ethernet cable must also support this speed, so I bought this Cat6 cable for it. On the NAS side, connect the second cable to the router. After configuring the router settings as explained in this guide, our NAS is ready to use. I transferred all my data to it, with a write speed of approximately 125-150 MB/s, and a read speed from 400-500 MB/s. That is, of course, when working with large files. To do that, I created network drives on my PC so that I could work with files from the NAS directly. Adobe Premiere Pro launched the project from the NAS without any problems, and the speed was sufficient for editing 4K videos. I edited my previous video this way, and most of this one too. Streaming movies over my home Wi-Fi network also works great, and it worked like this for almost 2 months. However, the speed of working with lots of small files reminded me that these are still hard drives. This is especially noticeable if you want to install any application. The installation takes forever, so does the launch time. But there is a way to improve this. As you probably remember, I have a 10 gigabit connection, and I was using only half of its potential. To fix this, I eventually decided to add SSDs. One for the cache, and other for applications and additional high-speed storage in general. I will briefly explain how the cache works and how it's connected to the RAM in the NAS. Here are my three hard drives in RAID 5. When we access data from this array, it will be written to our SSD. And the next time, when I access the same file, I will be able to get it directly from the SSD, which will give me a significant speed boost. And the information that there is a simplified path to the SSD for this file will be stored in RAM. In general, part of free RAM will be used for the cache anyway. This is the first level. And the second level of the cache will be the SSD. While I was gathering information about SSDs to choose the right one, Oracle approached me with an offer to try their SSDs. I replied that I was currently building a NAS and would be happy to test their drives and tell you about them. And now I have two SSD drives in my hands and they have everything I need. First of all, a screwdriver from the kit. Okay, I'm kidding. This is Oracle IG740 Pro. It uses TLC memory, which is a plus for readability and stability during continuous recording. It claims to support ECC error correction and power loss protection. Those are the features that are rarely found in consumer models and are really important for systems to run data pools. Besides a screwdriver, the kit also includes a thermal pad and heatsink to keep the temperature low under load, which will come in handy because my NAS is located under a closed shelf with a small ventilation hose. Since they operate on PCIe 4, the read-write speed will be overkill for NAS. But no one is saying that this SSD is only for NAS. It is also perfect for use in a PC or any other device. It offers a reasonable balance of price and quality for a home server like mine or a PC. And if you are currently looking for an SSD, I will leave a link in the description. So, I will configure one SSD for the cache, which is called L2ARC. This can be done in just a few clicks, and it's ready. To test it in action, I first need to read one of the files, and when I access it again, the read speed should increase. And it worked that way with the first file. But remember I said I needed to get more RAM? So I ran into a full RAM. The thing is that the cache can't work on its own. To test this, I bought a 32GB RAM module and replaced the old one with it. And yes, the difference was immediately noticeable. It is loaded into the cache, and the next copy is already taken from the cache. And now I can use the benefits of a 10GB connection. And when I check the RAM, now more than 17GB goes to the cache. It is important to note that these figures may vary for you, as much depends on the size of your storage. I have 24TB, and as far as I understand, ideally I need 1GB of free RAM for each terabyte of data. The second SSD will serve as a high-speed storage and for TrueNAS applications. Of course, you can install them on a hard drive, but they run much slower there. And even more importantly, they regularly use the hard drive. And I'm interested in completely removing the load from the hard drives. Soon, you will understand why. It is also worth mentioning that you can configure the cache for writing, but I don't mind waiting 5 minutes at the current speed. By the way, this is the moment when I regretted installing the OS on the M.2 SSD. I ran out of slots, so I had to transfer the OS to the SATA SSD. Fortunately, this is a fairly simple process because in TrueNAS, you can export the config file, then install a clean OS and import it there. Now my NAS works even faster, but there is still room for improvement. It is quite noisy, even though it has only 3 hard drives. It's impossible to hide it in my small apartment, so I keep it here. Yes, it turned out that I bought a nice case to hide it. It runs around the clock, consuming about 50 watts according to my measurements, but there is a way to put hard drives into standby mode if they are not used for a long time. For this purpose, my applications are installed on SSD, not on a hard drive. Then you need to reconfigure SMB to SSD, which is a lot of system logs that were regularly recorded on our hard drive. Then, in each of the drives, I set up standby mode, and I set the drives to stop after 30 minutes of inactivity. Now, when the drives are in standby mode, it is noticeably quieter and consumes less electricity. and as soon as I access some data on the drive, you may also have noticed that the case cover is open and that there is an additional fan on the hard drives. This is because the NAS is located in a poorly ventilated area, and I noticed that the temperature on the drives was around 55 degrees, when 60 is the maximum allowed. But OpenCase and this one fan solved the problem, and now their temperature averages 44 degrees. Also, I placed the NAS on foam to reduce vibrations, and now it's not as noisy and doesn't bother me. There are a couple more differences between my NAS and the cloud solution. If something happens to it physically, the data will be lost. What if there is a power surge, for example? This can be avoided by purchasing a UPS. By the way, TrueNAS can synchronize with a UPS. I will buy one in the future. If something happens to one of the drives, the RAID array will save the data on other two. But what if, let's say, there is a fire? In South Korea, in September 2025, a data center burned down, and with it, 858 terabytes of data. The losses cover 8 years of accumulated work. And as you can imagine, they didn't have a backup, so you have to be smarter. And to avoid this, you need a backup that is not located in your home. Of course, you can turn to a cloud solution, which is much cheaper than Google Drive and allows you to store data with limited functionality. Another option is to buy an additional, very simple NAS that will synchronize data from your main NAS on a daily basis, but it must be stored in another location, for example, at a friend's house. If you're afraid that someone will gain access to this data, you can encrypt it. But this is the only way to fully protect your important data. And yes, all this time my NAS was only accessible within my local network. All that remained is to connect it to the internet. And I can assume that no one would want to share their files with the entire internet, which is why this is done via VPN. The simplest option is TailScale. It's easy to install and configure. And once you're connected, you'll have the IP address of your NAS. This will allow you to access the admin panel or the application, since applications usually have the web interface and their own unique port in the URL. So I entered the photo gallery port via mobile internet, and now I can use it. I am extremely happy with the result, and I hope that this video will help you in some way with building your own NAS. Or I will be glad if you just found it interesting to watch. In the video description, I will leave the name of the components and links to them in case you want to repeat my build. It's my first NAS, and perhaps I made a mistake somewhere. So guys, if you're an expert in this topic, feel free to criticize. If that's something serious, I'll pin the comment so everyone can see it. Not sure if I'll be making more content on this topic in the future, so I won't be asking you to subscribe, but I would be happy if you support me with a like.